सबसे शुभ रात्रि सबके आनंदी एंड फ्रेंड्स अवेलेबल ओवरऑल टू स्पीक इन पांडियंस मेमोरी इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ डॉक्टर गांधी एंड इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ सो मेनी कलीग्स ऑफ माय प्रीवियस बर्थ I do not know if I'll be able to do justice to the occasion. I had a strange bond with the MSS. It was a sort of unspoken affinity, which I, the only other person with which I had that is also no more. That's D.R. Nagaraj. We came from very, very different traditions. He from Marxist and I from Lodhiite. Probably not so different now in 21st century, but those days it looked very different. Probably the affinity was that we wanted to look at caste. We took caste seriously. But I think there was also the other thing to which Anandi referred. It was willingness to take caste seriously without fetishizing it, without there being a fixity of its identity, which is the usual track in which those who take caste fall very easily. If caste matters, it's given, it's the only thing, and so on. I came to know him much later. Initially was just a distant admirer of his, especially of his book on politics, The Image Trap. Because I thought here was an example of someone who could see how images are manufactured and how they can be transferred from one domain to another. And I still believe those who want to understand the rise of Narendra Modi and some other politicians in our recent times would do well to revisit that book and to see this business of transference of images from one domain to another. The one close encounter, if I can call that, was that infamous NCRT episode when the government had appointed a committee explicitly with a view to serving the masters and giving a report whose conclusions were already decided. And I don't know why, but sheer mistakes. I mean, rulers make mistakes. They happened to put MSS on the committee. And they probably didn't know him enough or thought that, like most people in most professions, people can be bent the right way, MSS refused. So I appeared before a committee where he was sitting. And he interrogated us, me and Suhas Parshikar, ostensibly for having offended Dr. Ambedkar's memory. And systematically went about interrogating us with a in a way that made everything come out and have all the facts placed in public. The report, as I said, was predetermined. It was to be written the way it was ordered anyway. But I dare say, MSS Pandian's note of dissent would be one of those documents that would redeem Indian academia when the history of Indian academia's relationship to politics is written. That's why I had chosen this theme in keeping with Pandian's interest in caste, politics, images, modern democracy. I thought I would use this occasion to say something about rethinking politics of social justice. I should straight away clarify that I'm using the word social justice in the narrow sense in which for some reason it's used in India, namely to talk about caste-based justice movements. It's a very narrow usage, but that has become a popular usage. So you can't quarrel with words after a point. So social justice as it is used now. And I would also clarify that today I do not want to speak much about the policy of social justice, which is an entirely different domain, and I would love to talk about it, reservations and the entire, you know, range of policies around social justice. I'll focus on politics of social justice, which is what MS's passion was, to try and think about it. He didn't have much patience for these design things, you know, which I do have enormous interest in, how to design affirmative action policies and so on. He had greater passion for politics of it, the sheer raw politics of it. I thought I should speak about that. But today, we speak in a slightly different context than the one when I accepted this invitation. And therefore, allow me to add a subtitle to my talk. It is Rethinking Politics of Social Justice in the Wake of Rohit Vemula. We've seen something very unusual happen in this country in the last 10, 15 days. And it would only be appropriate that we begin by acknowledging what we have witnessed. What is the significance of this incident of Hyderabad, which has caught national attention after a long, long time? Something to do with caste, injustice, has caught national attention. Later on, we can analyze what exactly was it in this incident that made it caught attention. But let's simply notice what does this signify? First of all, of course, it needn't be repeated, that this incident reminds us of the fact of caste injustice, which is so deeply lodged inside our modern institutions. In ways, it's inscribed invisibly in our modern institutions. At the same time, this incident also reminds us of the resistance that is building up. As in the case of caste atrocity, we all know that most of the cases of caste atrocities that are reported are not necessarily from those areas or sections or domains where caste atrocity is at its worst. It comes from those areas where resistance has begun. In fact, from the worst areas or domains of caste oppression, there is almost never any reporting, because it takes something for these things to become reportable. Hyderabad University, as we know, is a very unusually vibrant university, and in one day I actually felt bad that this one of the finer universities of the country. Finer because this university has greater consciousness, the student community of this university has greater consciousness on questions of caste injustice than most universities of this country. This most visible case happens to come from that very university. But if we now see the logic of it, we should not be surprised that the reporting comes from places where resistance has actually begun. This incident reminds us of a certain reduction that we witness. If you notice, in Rohit's case, there was that little dispute about whether he's really an SC or not. Initially, of course, people gloss over the fact that it's not your certificate that you carry in your pocket or your file that matters. What matters is what you think you are and what everyone else thinks you are. That's what matters in this case. But interestingly, the assumption was that if your certificate happens to be not SC, but OBC or EBC, then any claim about caste injustice is a bogus claim. So the government representatives go about presenting the case as if the whole thing hinges on either producing an SC certificate or not producing it. Which is to say, the entire question of caste injustice is reduced to one formal boundary. Anything just outside that boundary is not quite caste injustice. I'll have something to say about this later. We also see in this very incident a pattern that's actually a very standard pattern. Initial denial followed by appropriation. Denial that anything happened at all. And later on, no less the Prime Minister of this country deeply regretting the fact that this country had lost this son, great son. Both things happen simultaneously. In fact, they happen in a sequence, but later on you actually see both of them operating at the same time. So denial come appropriation, or denial followed by appropriation. And would it go, we don't know, it's too soon for us to say. We have seen some things like this happen earlier too. Denial, appropriation, followed by amnesia, as if it never happened. This is a danger that we still face. It's too early to pronounce a judgment, and certainly I would not wish to jump to a sad judgment. But let us not forget that when all this attention is being paid to this question of caste, that is also the moment when no less than the Speaker of Lok Sabha has opinions about reservations being reconsidered. And in their vocabulary, reconsidered doesn't mean retuned or fine-tuned. It actually means junked. So this is a very delicate moment at which we speak. I would wish to argue that what we see in this incident, and if indeed it is denial, appropriation, amnesia pattern, which is what we have seen in the past, it reflects something of the failure of politics of social justice. Now that might sound like an odd claim. Odd because in some ways politics of social justice has succeeded like nothing else has. Began in heartland of South in the 60s, and by 80s and 90s, it is very much something that has captured the heartland of North India as well. Parties ostensibly claiming to be parties of social justice are in power almost everywhere. Or parties that do not call themselves parties of social justice have to include that dimension within their party. So Madhya Pradesh has to have an OBC chief minister, even if they don't have an SP-BSP kind of a party. BJP has to become that kind of a party. And not to forget the fact that our Prime Minister, one of the attributes that he has claimed for himself is that he is from an OBC. So in one sense, one could say that politics of OBC, especially OBC politics, has succeeded like very few things have succeeded in this country. The only states which are now outside the purview of rise of OBC politics could be Orissa, Bengal, and on that side maybe Rajasthan, Punjab. Most other states are very much, in a sense, part of that victory of OBC politics. You could also say that if there is one subject on which everyone in parliament is scared to say anything. It has something to do with SCST. In some very limited sense, this is the new sacred cow of Indian politics. SCST Atrocities Act passed without any discussion. Extension of reservation without any discussion. So someone could say that it is inappropriate to speak about failure of politics social justice because it has actually succeeded in a big way. I would argue that actually politics of social justice has reached something of a dead end. Professor Gopal Krishna Gandhi said something about our ability to take somewhat unpopular stand. So here is another fragment of that. I think politics of social justice, namely politics of those parties and movements which espouse the cause of hitherto socially deprived, OBC, SC, etc. There's very little exclusive ST politics in the country. It has reached a dead end. And what we witness in incidents of the kind that I've been talking about is actually examples of failure of politics of social justice. I would argue that politics of social justice is a victim of its own success. You talked about, you know, success producing all kinds of strange effects in some other context. But if there was an example of victims of success, this politics of social justice is a victim of its success. It has hit stagnation. It is a victim of fragmentation. What do I mean by stagnation? First of all, politics of social justice succeeded in one thing, namely to change the social character, social composition of elite, politics of presence. That is to say, in the sheer number of representatives that came from non-Brahmin, non-upper caste constituency, that profile has changed. It changed in a dramatic way in the South first, but over the last few years, it has changed in much less dramatic way, probably in a very dramatic way in Bihar, not so dramatic ways in others, but as Christoph Jaffleau's work has demonstrated, there is a clear decisive shift all over the country in caste composition of elected representatives. But the stagnation is that it stops here. Even within this transition, much of it stops at the upper layer of the OBC. The lower OBC, EBC or whatever different names it has in different parts of the country, continue to be very severely underrepresented. I would actually argue that our mental notion of Indian social hierarchy, in which you have upper caste, OBC and then Dalits, needs to be tweaked slightly. Actually, you have upper caste, you have upper OBC, then you have upper crust of SC, and the lower end of OBC actually comes below that, both in terms of political representation and in terms of their social, economic, educational profile. I don't have sufficient data, but I'm just throwing this invitation to many of my friends here who are more capable than I am to actually slice Indian society in these terms and then try and see if this hypothesis is correct. I think one of the sections which has consistently slipped and has lower OBC, which is primarily the erstwhile service communities, erstwhile craft communities, and many landless OBC communities, they have slipped certainly below that of the upper crust of the SC right now. So one failure is that while politics of presence has worked for a bloc called the OBC, but it has not worked for the lower end, bottom half at least, of the OBC. Secondly, it has been limited. The one big policy instrument that this politics has pushed, namely reservations, has been limited to a tiny and shrinking sector of Indian economy, namely the public sector. All, for all its success, for all the major strides that politics of social justice has made, all these parties have made, for all their ability to come to power, to remain in power, to ensure that chief minister always comes from now non-upper caste communities. But then, the regime of affirmative action has not been extended beyond the public sector, and public sector is a sector which in the last 20 years has shrunk, if not in numbers, certainly in proportions. That's the other major limitation it has faced. Third is the limitation of vision. In none of these parties which represent social justice do you see a larger vision of India which is in any way different from the parties they seek to replace. Look at the manifestos, look at the policy documents, and tell me what is the economic policy of Samajwadi Party, technically the Socialist Party of India, which is in any way different from Congress, from BJP. Or forget the manifestos, as we know, no one reads them except academics or journalists. Look at their actual policy pronouncements. Look at their policies when they are in power. Do you see any difference at all in the overall economic policy? Any difference at all in the overall vision of India? When new classes come to political power, one of the big things they do is that they bring with them a new vision. I'm trying to suggest that the great OBC upsurge in Indian politics failed to do that. It has actually fallen prey exactly to the same vision. They have been trapped by the same vision as had been handed over to them by the parties they sought to oppose. And fourthly, in their politics, have they adopted different political method, different instruments, different kind of politics? I'm afraid no. The political instruments that they have used, the parties that they have created, are no different. In fact, it may be safe to say that parties representing the lower orders of society are more undemocratic than the rest of the parties in our world. So the great irony here is that the democratizers of Indian politics are internally much less democratic than anyone else. So this, to my mind, is what I call stagnation of their politics. This politics brings something, but stops well short of what it could have done, what it was meant to do. Add to that the fragmentation of politics. Fragmentation of politics of social justice. One which is very well known, fragmentation along regional lines. When we talk about regional parties in India, most of the regional parties are parties that actually represent the interest of OBC, SC, ST Muslims. these parties are effectively fragmented on regional lines. But it's not just regional. There is a social fragmentation. There has not yet been a single successful experiment. Dalit Adivasi alliance in Indian politics has simply not happened. In the case of Dalit OBC, not only has successful alliances, I mean, I would not say it has never happened, but I think it's safe to say that there is a relationship of mutual hostility that has developed over the years. So far from an alliance, politics of OBC and politics of Dalit actually has diverged. Bihar was one place where there was an attempt for almost 10 years to bring it together. By now that has also diverged. And this big success which is being celebrated right now, for some good reasons, unfortunately happens to be a case when this, where also this divergence gets consolidated. So we have a stagnation, we have a fragmentation of politics of social justice. I think it is basically a function of something like this. When a new kind of politics, a new kind of force enters public arena, it needs a little shield for itself. It needs a little exclusivity. It is understandable that lower caste politics, OBC-SC politics, started with certain demands of exclusivity. Don't want to deal with others, we are separate, our things are different, and so on. It was necessary. In the initial period, this requirement of exclusivity, this demand of not mingling with others, this requirement of not forming larger coalitions was understandable. It was almost necessary at that time. However, in the long run, the same requirement, the same exclusivity has now become a burden, has now become a limitation. And today we are dealing with those limitations. So what we need right now is a move forward. We need, as it were, a second wind of politics of social justice. What would that second wind be like? I can only make a few proposals. I do not know whether that would be translated in reality. I can certainly not say whether it would happen very soon. These are only suggestions and proposals about the direction in which this politics must go. As must be obvious from what I'm saying, there is need for new integration. Politics of social justice has remained fragmented for far too long. There is a need for uniting politics of lower caste, politics of social justice as it is called, across the regional divide. It is not easy. It is not easy because the social concerns, requirements vary from region to region. It's not very easy to stitch it. There were good reasons why it became regional in the first place. But I think the period when it served a very positive purpose may have come to an end. It is important now to stitch that together. More importantly, it is absolutely important to stitch the various social segments together. If OBC and SC politics in particular were to keep diverging, Bahujan and Dalit politics were to keep diverging in the way in which it has diverged in the last 20 years or so, I think it would straight away play into the hands of the established politics. There already are attempts to do so. As many of us would have noticed, BJP's ploy and trick in many states is actually to stitch an old Congress-like coalition in which you have a solid block of upper caste vote with you. You bypass the OBC and you go straight to the left. So a strong upper caste base with some support among the lower order of the OBC and some sections of the left. That is, this is a slightly different version of the Congress coalition of the 60s, 70s. Congress, of course, also had plus Muslims in that. Now, because the politics, political parties, political forces representing OBC Dalit politics have not been able to forge a unity, it lends itself to this fracturing and disuse. So this, to my mind, is an absolute imperative. Not even in the medium run, I would say in the short run, it is an absolute imperative of politics of social justice. Second, related to that, is recognizing multidimensionality of inequality and injustice. For far too long, political forces of social justice have operated with a unidimensional understanding of injustice, which is to say, the whole world denies caste, therefore we shall talk only about caste and nothing else. This is the response. I understand that response, given the manner in which it was denied. And 20 years ago, I mean, I clearly remember late 80s, early 90s, somehow something happened in the early 90s with Mandela. But how difficult it was in the Indian academia to talk about caste. Now this picture has changed. Now, in fact, one has to persuade the same old friends to look at things other than caste as well. But 20 years ago, you could not talk about caste in that sense. So I understand the reaction to say, okay, caste is the only thing. But now I think this is clearly doing disservice to politics of social justice. We need to recognize at least four dimensions of inequality that simultaneously operate in the Indian setting. Caste, class, rural, urban, and gender. These four dimensions, which work in an intersectional way. The gender inequality itself has different gradations from urban India to rural India, for urban upper caste family to rural lower caste family. So unless we operate with this complex grid of injustice and inequality, the politics that we come up with is very flat-footed and in the long run counterproductive. This of course means a willingness to incorporate this understanding into our policies and our positions. When RSS chief or the Lok Sabha speaker says we should revisit reservation, the first response is, oh, this is an attack. We must defend this system at all costs. So we end up reproducing a mirror image of what they are saying. I really think it's time to move beyond this defensive mentality and actually proposals for refining and improving affirmative action schemes should come from defenders of social justice. We should not wait for a Mohan Bhagwat. We should not wait for someone else. We should be proposing. Defenders of social justice must be proposing how to refine this, how to fine-tune this. I have argued this in the past with very little effect, I must confess. But here is one more attempt to do so, which is that the system of affirmative action in India, which has two reductions. One, all kinds of inequalities are reduced to caste. And two, all kinds of instruments are reduced to reservation. Caste as the only inequality and reservation as the only mechanism for addressing this. This was perhaps a useful way to start a regime of affirmative action. But we have reached a point where we really need to rethink this, where we need to move beyond it. And moving beyond it doesn't mean to fall into that silly trap of saying, you know, poverty is the only form of injustice and let's have reservation on economic ground, etc. I mean, nothing can be more silly than that. But to try and think of a more complex grid, I often draw upon Satish Deshpande's work on this, and I think it's a very instructive work about how we can begin to redesign affirmative action, keeping in mind intersectional and graded inequalities, and how we can think about instruments in addition to reservations, not to replace. But we need to think about instruments in addition to reservation. Reservation is the instrument of the last resort, which may still well be needed. In the case of Dalit Adivasi, this is probably an instrument which still has merit for another 20 years or so. But for all other kinds of affirmative action, we need not reduce everything only to this. I have written about it this in length, made a few proposals about this. I would not bore you with all those things. But this would take a lot of political will to say that. It is going to be difficult. And anyone who takes this plank would risk losing a few votes at least to begin with. But this courage is must if we really wish to see even a medium-term success for what we call politics of social justice. If it has to go beyond the first wind that it got, the second wind requires intellectual preparedness. It requires bold policy thinking. It requires being able to see the medium horizon. It also requires something of a longer horizon, which is claims to universality. For some reason, again understandable, politics of social justice has given up on its ambition to provide a vision for the entire country. And we have these stereotypical situations in which those who come from upper caste speak for the nation. Those who come from OBC and SC speak only for their own community. We have this sad, ridiculous situation where politicians coming from Dalit Bahujan background do not even have the ambition. They have the ambition of becoming the Prime Minister of the country, but they do not have the ambition of becoming leaders of this country. They cannot see that because that politics does not have a universalist vision built into it. I do understand that again, because coming from a margin, you begin with a sectional view. Your initial energy is spent into defending the sectional view that you come with. But the sign of a mature and confident politics is then to say, I do not represent a section. I represent this country. Or possibly, I represent something beyond the national borders of this country. That universality, claims of universality, ambitions of universality, a politics that goes beyond a narrow sectional view of things, is something which is sorely missing right now. And that is, to my mind, the direction in which we all can move. I do believe that this invitation to universality is implicit in M.S.S. Pandian's work, Between the Lines. This is where he speaks to that identity, he speaks to that concreteness. At the same time, he invites us to think about something much beyond that specificity that he talks about. And I believe, I read this appeal to that universality in that beautiful letter. It's strange to say beautiful, but it is beautiful. The beautiful letter that Rohit Memula wrote. This refusal in the face of death to blame, his refusal to be petty, his refusal to resent, and his desire for something that reaches stars, literally. At least I see, call me an eternal optimist, but I see fragments of that universality in the response that his death has evoked. After a very long time, we have an incident of caste injustice which has touched populations certainly beyond such incidents have evoked in the past. I do read a possibility in that. I do read signs of something much bigger, something much deeper. Trying for that and transforming politics of social justice in that light would be in the spirit of that letter, and that would be the right tribute to M.S.S. Pandian. To clarify, supplement the points that I have made somewhat hurriedly. One small clarification. As I said right in the beginning, for whatever reason in India, the politics of social justice has acquired connotations of caste-based injustice and responses to it. And I had said right in the beginning that I'll confine myself to this, which does exclude a discussion on minorities, religious minorities, and what's happening there. I had an occasion 3 days ago to talk about that in Mangalore, but that's the only reason I kept it out. The one segment I did miss out, even within my own scope, and that's a weakness, is some discussion about DMT communities, the denotified tribes, and the nomadic communities. I really, really think that if there is truly one segment of our population which has suffered most under democratic India, it is this community that no one speaks about. You know, we have learned to talk about Dalits in the last 20 years, but about DMT, the kind of injustice that takes place even today would remind us of slavery in slavery 200 years ago. So that's a limit. You know, the trouble is that these are communities which are numerically so small and further underrepresented on electoral rolls because of their nomadic nature, that modern democracy simply does not work. I mean, we simply don't have instruments to respond to this nature of injustice. So that was a real weakness for me. I apologize. Two questions about the nature of affirmative action regime and proposals to do with that. One is about reservations in promotion, and second is about creamy air. Most defenders of politics of social justice have taken somewhat stiff position on both these questions. They have said that reservation in promotion is a logical extension of the regime of affirmative action, and that any attempt to block it is denial of the very argument of social, the argument of preservation. They have also said that creamy layer is an illogical insertion, somewhat clumsy, that I would agree. It's a very clumsy sort of insertion by the Supreme Court. Proponents of social justice have said that a creamy layer itself is an illogical notion, that in fact benefits of reservations can only be obtained by those communities which have had some privileges, otherwise they cannot take advantage, and therefore we should abandon the very idea of creamy layer. I happen to disagree on both these counts. I do think that the regime of affirmative action must have not just legal sanctity, not just approval from Supreme Court, it must enjoy moral legitimacy in the rest of society. And I think in the last 20 years, while courts have taken a reasonably progressive position, proponents of social justice have kept losing ideological battles. This is my reading of Mandal 2 and Mandal 3, Mandal 2 particularly, that actually there was a regression, that in terms of moral arguments, at least opponents of reservations have come up with new and innovative argument every time. Probably such deep is their anxiety that they come up at least with something innovative. Defenders of social justice have not come up with any innovative arguments. And I think my real fear, which may appear far-fetched right now, but I think we should be concerned about it, is that this entire regime of affirmative action, represented by reservations, which is such a special achievement of post-independence India, not many countries have had something like this. And if you look at US Supreme Court and their judgments, you would know how difficult it is to sustain something like this for 50, 60 years. I fear that some over-enthusiasm can actually kill it. And I feel that the stand taken by supporters of affirmative action, both on promotion, reservation in promotion and creamy layer, may represent that over-enthusiasm which may be dangerous in the long run. I therefore would propose that in the case of reservation in promotion, one should actually, if the parliament is looking at it and developing a nuanced policy, I would not make that to be the center point of my political opposition. Second, on creamy layer, clumsy as it is, this notion enables us to address a very widespread anxiety and a widespread propaganda. The propaganda is this: oh my God, these people keep getting benefits of reservation one generation after another. Look at this daughter of an IAS officer, she's getting reservation. Oh my God, the country's doomed. This is the propaganda. You need a moral instrument, moral legal instrument to counter. The idea of creamy layer enables you to say, no, the policy is more nuanced. Even if that net catches 2%, let that net be there. I do believe that the definition of, that while we should not attack the very idea of creamy layer, the operational definition of creamy layer should be enlarged, which is to say, we should allow normal middle class to come, normal middle class should not be caught within that net of the creamy layer. That is to say, the monetary limit should be enhanced considerably, but the idea should not be changed. On the challenge of money and position opposed to OBC and SC politics, I do not see how it is particularly so for OBC and Dalit and not for the rest. This is the general nature of challenge that any movement faces. And so does Dalit OBC politics. The only thing is that they face it more intensely than others because these politicians come from particularly deprived background. And this is where This is where ideology, principles, and a certain training in educational movement politics makes a difference. On attempt by on the left, I excluded the left because I actually do believe that the left's response to caste inequality has been very, very inadequate, to put it mildly. Except in the case of Kerala, where they happen to inherit a background where it's not, it's despite themselves, that left actually became a carrier of lower caste politics. But if you look at the rest of the country, in West Bengal, for example, I really think of the left as an extension of Bhadlo politics. So that's why it's hard for me to think of left as offering falling within that larger constituency. But if you were to extend the word social justice in a larger sense, which is not just caste injustice, but also to think of economic and so on, then of course left should be there. But I was operating with a very narrow definition for the time being. In the case of Aam Aadmi Party, I think what it has done of late, I mean, there were serious contestations on this question within the Aam Aadmi Party, but then I would not get into all the details of what those contestations were. We can talk about it later. But basically, broadly, the contestations were between a simple view that refuses to acknowledge, which says that, I mean, there are two ways in which you can transcend caste centrality. A, by acknowledging it and saying we need to take a multidimensional view where caste happens to be one of the critical indicators but not the only one. And second, by saying there is no need to acknowledge it. I think the Aam Aadmi Party has taken the second view. To my mind, that view is unsustainable. If you read some of the documents released by the party recently on the SCST question, on the Dalit question, my sense is that the language is not very different from the language used by RSS on the Dalit question. But do read it, form your own opinion. I'm a prejudiced person, so don't take my word for it. Read it. And it is such a pity. It is a pity because here was a great opportunity to actually practice multi-dimensional politics. You know, a new political entrant always brings in new possibilities. And every possibility not realized is a pity. And indeed, on the question of caste, it is a pity. On the North-South difference, that's very important. I'm glad you asked that. Because in many ways, the politics of social justice in the South is much richer, with much deeper consequences. Whatever theater takes place in Tamil politics. But the fact is that some of the welfare measures which are embedded now in governance in Tamil Nadu are incomparable to anything you find in the rest of North India. You cannot imagine some of these things that are happening in Tamil Nadu. Did I touch an emotional chord there? I'm just making a flat statement of the previous provisions on health and such like. So I think the OBC politics of the South, if I could use that broad expression, the South, could institute it in terms of policies. The other very big difference is that it could also institute itself in terms of educational institutions. Now, I do know that most of these institutions are shops, but shops serve a purpose. So I would at the moment not look at it as an educationist and allow myself to be scandalized by the manner in which these shops work. But the fact is that this part has shops, the other part does not even have shops. And which makes a huge difference. So the manner in which, especially OBC politics, translated itself into North and South has been very different. The politics of the South has had much deeper, the third thing is that OBC politics of the South learned to take a differentiated view of the OBC. Something like, the kind of reports Karnataka has produced. Justice Hanuma Commission report. Yesterday someone corrected me on the pronunciation, so I'm just trying to get it right. Justice Hanuma Commission report of OBC in Karnataka. I think that sets gold standards of how these things should be done. Something resembling that is simply not available in North India. So there is that difference. One can get into a long thing of why historically those differences have evolved. But at the moment, North Indian politics is just beginning to catch up with some of these things. And probably some of these things may never be produced. Just two quick things. Giri's questions reminded me of my older days in academia. Grappling with that thing. I take your point about social structure and consciousness to mean something that I should have said actually in my lecture, which is that politics, which was ostensibly a politics of annihilation of caste, has allowed itself to become a casteist politics. This is one of the biggest tragedies of OBC. If that is close to your question, then that's something I should acknowledge. I didn't fully understand all the implications of the question. And on the universality part of it, I think it is true that the language of universality was captured once by a tiny part of the globe and was used to peddle its limited versions of the universe on the rest of the globe. But now that we have begun to develop cultural confidence and have begun to see that tiny part of the globe as just a province and no more, I think it's time for us to reclaim universality. Let us not make the mistake that Mulayam Singh Yadavs of the world have made, namely to see themselves as restricted to a tiny thing and universality being claimed by someone else. I think we should claim that universality in modes different from the universality that came to us in the last 150 years. And your own question, so beautifully worded, contains some of the clues about how we can rework that universality. Thanks for those questions.